Amen. Good morning. Well, today we're going to jump on in to the second lesson of our series of Love God and Love People. Amen. The title of today's lesson, Love God, Love People, Part 2, The Five Love Languages of the Lord. Today I want to talk about what makes God feel loved. And yet, an amazing thing is that in times of transition, people tend to pull their hearts back and not show love. And I thought today's service has just been phenomenal. I don't know about you, but where in this world can you go and see someone restored to the Lord, come up and apologize to him in the family of God? See such a phenomenal young woman become a disciple of Jesus. And have such an amazing communion where someone gives you their heart and just puts it on out there, you know. Speaks real and honest, radically changed, and says, oh, by the way, that's because of God. And I thought Mason and Natalie did a phenomenal job as well. I mean, has the Lord not blessed us with these two phenomenal couples here today? It's great to have you here today. And that lack of clapping is why we need to talk about love right there. That's what we got to talk about today. You know, I got all my notes right now, right? Yeah, we're never going to go there right away yet. I think we need to have a little talking Jesus here. What is our mantra? Love God, love people. What is it?
Love God, love people.
And yet, this was not a very loving service as we came in today. I just got to hit it head on because I'm the preacher, right? It was quiet, hearts pulled back. We serve a more awesome God than to treat him like that, let me tell you. It's really awesome to have Sabrina here. She's such a special gem. She's such a phenomenal gem in God's kingdom. And you're a very special lady. And God has already done amazing things with you. And gosh, what he's gonna do is phenomenal. I mean, we love you with all of our heart. And it's, you know, I'm a mama's boy. It's good to see my mom here with Corey's mom sitting here. On your heart and mind today, what an incredible day for him that he gets to go and see his son graduate from college, you know. I mean, athlete of the week twice for his division. I mean, what a phenomenal day. You know, Corey is a mama's boy, but a proud papa as well. And I mean, we should spend some time sending some text messages of encouragement there. What a phenomenal day for him. We know we miss him greatly. And yet, I love to be able to be here, to be able to take Wazira and take care of her here and take her home after service, because she's just like a mom to me now as well. And I love you with all my heart, Mama. So, and yet, I gotta wonder, you know, Corey and I over the last year have built such a phenomenal friendship. I mean, we are dear partners in the gospel and dear friends. And I just gotta wonder how on Wednesday, if I'm so united with Corey, how so many of you are not united with me. And I'm a real guy, so I'm just gonna put it out there for the congregation. I was very sad to know our mantra is love God, love people, and to hear the comments of, I don't like this new leadership. And it's saddening. It's saddening, and I think we're better than that. And we're just gonna put it out there so it can just be done. I just want to share my heart with you first before we get into the lesson. So, Tracy and I have been part of the kingdom for 23 years. And quite frankly, because of people pulling their hearts back, not giving their hearts to one another, not being honest with each other, and having different motives and ambitions, the family of churches that I enjoyed for so many years fell apart. And we were here in Los Angeles, dead spiritually. And so, you know, we went to Portland and saw our church that we had always been a part of. It wasn't the preacher. It wasn't the people. We went and we saw a fellowship We saw zeal and passion. We saw focus on the Lord, not on people.
Yeah.
And yet, during transition, how do we get so focused on people if we're really focused on God?
Come on, Ron.
During that time was such a sad time to see brothers and sisters not welcome each other in, not embrace each other, and yet pull apart from each other. And it just crushed us. I mean, for me personally, I almost lost my faith. And yet, the Bible says, for the joy set before him, Jesus endured the cross and scorned the shame. And so once we were in Portland, I came back to visit to LA the first time. I saw my brothers and sisters hurting. And I knew it was time to do something about it. And, you know, we moved to Portland, and 9 weeks later moved back here to start this church. And what have we gone through to have this church? Well, we started with 12 people. We didn't even fit the whole first row of this room. And I had people put bags of dog poop on my doorstep, write letters, hate letters. I was getting about 150 hateful emails every day, cursing and all kinds of crazy stuff from people who called themselves believers. And yet, for the joy set before me, that's why we started this church, so we could once again have a family of God here in Los Angeles. And here's the deal. You may not have asked for me, and I didn't ask for you, but here we are. And I love God, and I love people, and I'm going to love you whether you love me back. And that's just it. I will not have people take things like when we honor our brothers and sisters as heroes in the faith, people call it rah-rah. I will not have that in our congregation. I will not tolerate people treating each other like that. It's just not going to go down. We honor one another. What we did on Wednesday was phenomenal. To see a teen up here giving her heart. Let's not ever reduce things to rah-rah and complaining like that. Let's get on into the lesson. Amen. Love God, love people. The five love languages of the Lord. Let's turn our Bibles to Luke chapter 11. Luke chapter 11. Today I want to get real specific about the concepts of loving God deeply. We talk about having quiet times, right? Some people talk about having loud times, right?
Yeah.
And yet today I want to talk about having a quality time. Luke chapter 11 and verse 1. The Bible says one day Jesus was praying in a certain place. And when he finished, it changed 12 guys. How do we know? Because they said, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. He said, when you pray, say, Father. Now, he's not intending that we say, Father God, Father God, Father God, Father God. I mean, if I went and I said, Tracy, you're so awesome, Tracy. Tracy, I love you, Tracy. Please stay married to me, Tracy. She'd kind of look at me funny, you know? And yet, we need to address God as our Father. I hope you really do view God as your Father, who always does everything for your best interest. Our prayers would be a lot stronger if we really started out with Father. It says, Father, hallowed be your name. Wow, okay. This is the concept of telling God how great he is. How great is your God in your mind? How powerful is he? How all-knowing is he? How loving and compassionate and great is he? In your mind, how mighty are his deeds? Do you tell him about it? Do you spend a great deal of time telling him who he is to you?
Amen.
See, when you think about writing a love letter to your interest, or your wife, or your husband, what words shall I choose that can convey to you how I feel about you? That's what God wants from you.
Yeah.
The words really don't matter. It's really the heart. We often go to God first with problems. Why does it happen to me, God? Why this person? Why that person? Why this? Why that? And yet, we'd understand a whole lot more why if we'd start out with understanding how powerful God is.
Yeah.
Your problem, the greater your God is in your mind and the more time you spend telling him that, the smaller your problems get.
Yeah.
Sometimes, if you spend enough time telling God how great he is, you don't even need to pray about the problem anymore. He says, Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Well, you know, it's interesting that the second part of the prayer, you know, is about the kingdom. How special is this treasure to you that we have in the kingdom? Is it really everything? You see, God, it's not just even the words. We know because these guys ran to him and said, teach us to pray like this, that he didn't just run through this Lord's Prayer like you hear it.
Yeah.
Father, hallowed be your name, thy kingdom come. We know that that's not what he was doing because they wouldn't have been so fired up about that.
Right. Exactly.
And yet it's not just the categories that he's picking to pray about, but it's also the order in which they're praying that's important because it sets priority in our mind. And he says, give us each day our daily bread. The fourth thing said, the fourth category is finally back to you.
Yeah.
Then he says, forgive us our sins. You know, we wouldn't hide so much sin or stay in sin so much longer if we talked to God about our sin more.
Yeah.
I think we get faked out because we know he already knows. So we think we don't need to talk about it. But then when you get old enough where you have kids and you know they're doing something wrong and they're not telling you, you don't want them to just keep not telling you. You're like, just get it out. Just talk to me about it. And yet somehow we fake ourselves out that God doesn't feel like that.
Right.
And he already knows and doesn't need to hear us talk about it. And yet we need to talk about it. Not only talk about it, we need to ask him to forgive us for it, even though we know he already has. Because it's really more for you than for him. And yet, if you don't talk about your sin, do you think God feels loved? Then he moves on and he says, for we also forgive who? Who? Who's it say right there? We forgive everyone. Have you? That's the question. It's funny that God sets this incredible priority. Forgive me for my sins. And then he stops us in our tracks because we know we can't be forgiven if we don't forgive. And so he calls us to pray about that. And then he moves on and he says, and lead us not into temptation. We can even get an attitude with the Lord that like he didn't protect us enough, so we got into sin. And I don't know, have you ever been there? I've been there before. Why in the world did you let me do this? Now I'm suffering from it. Oh, wait a minute. I forgot to ask if you'd protect me from it. See, we know ourselves, don't we? We know what temptations we have. We know what drags us away. We know what gets us upset. See, you ever heard the concept pushing a button? That's a big topic in marriage, you know. She just keeps pushing my button.
Oh, man.
Well, in your prayer life, how come you don't just get rid of the button and there's nothing to push? Then there's nothing to forgive. I mean, we know the Bible to say do everything without complaining. So if you have something you know you're going to complain about if somebody does it, why not just get rid of the desire to complain? And yet, talking through all these things about all the different areas in your life is what makes God feel loved because he wants your heart. Turn over to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 20.
Come on, bro.
See, because a relationship is a two-way thing, right?
Yeah.
So if I go to lunch with RD like we do often, and he just does all the talking and I say nothing, what is that all about? And somehow we think, okay, well, you know, I said a prayer, but I didn't read my Bible yet today. And we just really got to call it what it is. What we said is, God, talk to my hand. Talk to the hand. I'll do all the talking today. Because there's two-way communication. And there's got to be quality time where there's awesome communication both ways. Amen? And in Ephesians chapter 20, we learn about God's communication to us in what our church is built on, the Bible says. Verse 20, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. So where do you find the writings of the prophets? In the Old Testament. And you find the writings of the apostles in the New Testament. You got it? Okay, good. And so we've got to go to the apostles and to the prophets and let God speak to us through them. Amen? And I'm not just talking about the Spurgeon scripture of the day, fraction of a verse that comes on your cell phone. I'm talking about digging and reading and studying and loving. How could we not study our Bible deeper than we ever studied anything in school and say we love God with all of our heart? This is a relationship, and there are love languages. And the first one and foremost is that God says, please spend quality time with me. I need you. Jesus feels loved. The Lord feels love when you spend quality time with him. Amen?
Amen.
Go to John chapter 14.
Come on, bro.
Words of affirmation.
All right.
Love it.
Words of affirmation. John chapter 14. Don't you love when somebody just really builds you on up and speaks well of you and says how awesome you are, how incredible you are? Jermaine really loves it. He gets all fired. He starts jumping out of the seat, you know? Yeah, bro! Come on, man! Talk about it! Yeah! And you know, we do the Father, hallowed be your name thing, but you know, I come to find that there's a truth in life, and that is that not everybody believes what you say. But everybody believes what you do, don't they? And so it's with that that we read John chapter 14, verse 21. Whoever has my commands and obeys them, he's the one who loves me. Now this is cool. He who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love him and show myself to him. God loves to reveal himself to you. Every new relationship, he's revealing himself to you in some way. Every hardship and challenge, he's revealing himself to you some way. And yet, if you won't trust him and obey him, he can't show himself to you. Then all you see is a problem. You know, with God, when we have with kids, those of us who have children really understand this concept. They really need us to lift them up and build them up. And we really, really need them to obey what we tell them to do. You know what I'm saying? And yet God makes it very clear here, like when you don't obey me, you don't love me. You love you. And you know he'll say, I'm just doing me. And we can't just do me. Throughout the life of being a disciple, we've got to do God and his word and obey him. The words of affirmation that we say with our life is, I trust you and I will obey you. And God says, that means you love me. Thirdly, acts of service.
Yes.
1 Corinthians 15, verse 58. Oh, you love it when people serve you. We all love it. And yet, I hope to shift our mindset that we come here not to be loved, but to give love. Thinking of what act of service can I give to the Lord? What act of service can I give to my brother or my sister who's down? You can see it. You come in, you walk up to somebody, you can see it in their eyes.
Yeah.
I mean, as I look out at all of you, I can see which of you need encouragement.
Yeah.
And, you know, which of you are going to give encouragement. You can see it on our faces. And I hope you're going to pay attention to that and meet the need. Because if you just wait on a couple of leaders to take care of it, people walk out not encouraged.
Yeah.
They walk out still down. How sad if somebody comes into the house of God needing us and we let them leave without what they need. 1 Corinthians 15, 58. Therefore, my dear brothers, let nothing move you. Stand firm. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord. You know, it even gives us the reason why. Now, have you ever, like, gone all out for somebody? You just, like, just really wanted to encourage them, and you just went the extra mile, and, man, you just gave your heart, and then it, like, didn't mean anything to you?
Yeah. A couple times.
Like, oh. Well, you know, the Bible says right here that we work always because you know that your labor in the Lord's not in vain.
Right.
You know, God never forgets anything you do.
Yeah.
It always means more to God than you could ever understand.
Yeah.
See, God doesn't treat us like those people that don't care about what we do or forget about what we do.
Yeah.
And when we come to find that most is when we really are down and we're really focused on people and we're really not feeling love, God just jumps in there and just gives you something awesome because of something you did a long time ago that you even forgot about. He's always there to encourage you. I love the poem Footprints. You know, he's always carrying us and we don't realize it. And yet, we need to give our heart to him and to each other. When I think of acts of service, I think of the different areas of the church where different people are serving. And, we have our Kingdom Kids, and what an incredible thing. I mean, seriously, what would you do if you had to keep them all right here with you? Wow. A few of you would like that. I'd like to have my kids here. They're obedient. But if you're like me, most of us, we'd like be going crazy if our kids were right there next to us all the time. And yet, Hector and Wendy served in our Kingdom Kids for 4 years. 4 years. That deserves a standing ovation, I mean. Years. I've never even heard of that before. I've been around 23 years and I've never even heard of that. I've heard of people overseeing it, but not like being in there every week doing it like that. That's phenomenal. Thank you so much. I think about our ushers, you know, Richard Cato, Kenrick, all the guys. Now, please be merciful to me if I leave your name out. I'm not meaning to, please. But, I mean, you think about all the ushers. So they come in early. They put the songbooks on the chairs. If we have handouts, they put the handouts. They try and actually get you to sit by each other so it's like loving and everything. And they set up the banner. They set up the stage. They work like crazy. Most of us are still asleep while they're doing what they're doing here. And then, you know, we leave the place, and do you think it's really clean in here when we all leave? Like, it's not clean. And they clean up after us. Like they're the janitors for the kingdom. And I want to thank all of you guys for your service. Let's not make them the janitor. Let's just clean up after ourselves. You know? It's a great concept. You know, it's awesome. I think about our dear Julie back here, who makes the communion bread, does the wine. One of our most fruitful sisters in the whole church here. And she just loves God and loves people with all of her heart. That woman texts me constantly over and over and over just to encourage me. And it just lifts my soul all the time. Thank you. Now, can you imagine our like no sound at all, no speakers, nothing for joyful noise to bellow out of? AJ's here always. I mean, wow. Kevin's back there running the sound. Ricky's running around with the camera getting the baptisms and... What a phenomenal service they provide. I mean, for me, I've been a sound guy all 23 years. I've been a disciple. And I know how much work it is. And guys, thank you so much that, you know, I don't have to do it finally. That's awesome. What would our singing be like if there weren't five song leaders up here serving the church? I mean, Patrick has been leading the song leaders ever since he's been here, coordinating everybody, giving his heart, coming at 8:30 every morning, and, you know, helping them to sing on key. That can be a challenge sometimes, you know? And, you know, Mason's taking that over, and that's going to be great. And Michael's going to head up the song leading, and he's doing a fantastic job. And where's Joyful Noise? Where are the members of Joyful Noise standing up for a second here? Stand on up. These guys are truly world-renowned. They're known all over the world. Everybody wants to have a singing group in their church like Joyful Noise. Their service is not just when they're up here singing. That's the smallest fraction of their service to the church. Yeah. All the practicing and the, no, bro, that's not on key. No, we can't do that. There's a lot that goes into getting these songs awesome. Yeah. And they are top notch every time they get up here. Thank you so much. I think the most unsung servants that give acts of service to God without recognition are our Bible Talk leaders. If you're a Bible Talk leader, stand on up. Stand on up if you're a Bible Talk leader. I mean, these guys make those calls. Hey, can you bring this part of the food? Can you bring that part of the food? They're vacuuming, setting up chairs. And then, you know, hey, I got into sin. Okay, let's talk. I know it's 3 a.m. That's okay. Let's get together. Let's talk about it. Oh, get your stats in. Come on, get your stats in. You know, where's the study at? There's so much that goes in to this church being awesome. God sees all of it. Who cares if a man sees it? God sees all of it. And yet, Proverbs 13:12 says something very key. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. And many of us have great hopes, great ambitions, incredible things we want to see, even for the Lord, not just ourselves. And yet, when they don't happen in the time frame we want, we can get really hurt. And, you know, we can say, oh, well, this man didn't put me in this leadership role, or this man did that and shifted and changed everything, but the Lord let it happen. In our heart of hearts, we really know that. And we get really hurt by God. And, you know, I don't know if you've ever been there, where you felt hurt by the Lord that he didn't answer your prayer, or, and we feel let down. And we pull our heart back when that happens. And, you know, you're an integral part of this church. Am I speaking to you directly? Yes. Each one of you. What would our service be if you weren't here right now? What it would be is somebody would be thinking, where are you? Instead of thinking about the Lord and how awesome he is. And so you have a part to sing with all of your heart. We talk about being on time. It's just respectful for the Lord. It's a service. It's an act of service to come here and to be ready to sing when the singing starts. And yet, I want you to know, I need you here. I need your voice. I need your heart. Because we're a family. And don't make your family members wonder where you're at. And diminish the worship of God, because he's too great of a God for us to not be able to focus completely on him when we come in this room. Turn to James chapter 4. Turn to James chapter 4. When we get that vertical relationship going where we're really truly only focused on God. This is what causes us to lose that. James 1 verse 4. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Now I know there's no fights or quarrels amongst anybody here, so it's probably not going to apply, but I figured I'd just read it anyway, you know? What causes fights and quarrels among you? They come because you were sinned against, right? They come because somebody didn't keep their word to you. Or something changed that you expected to stay the same. No, don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You want something, but don't get it. It says you kill and covet. See, we kind of write that off. Like, we don't kill and covet. I don't kill and covet. I just got an attitude. Attitudes kill people spiritually. Attitudes show we covet things other people have that God has done for them. He says, but you can't have what you want with an attitude. He says, you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you don't ask God. Think about that quality time with God. See, starting with asking and not telling how great he is not asking to him. See, telling him how awesome he is, telling him how powerful he is, how great he is, how awesome it is to be in the kingdom and to pray for all the churches worldwide, to pray for the advancement of the kingdom. See, in that kingdom come is a twofold prayer. Because we're praying for God's visible church universal here on earth, but we're also praying for him to come back. Judgment day. Boy, would your life change a whole lot if you were praying for judgment day to come as quickly as possible? God, let today be judgment day. Woo, you'd live a lot different. Yeah. You let go of that attitude. Nobody would get by you without hearing about God. Okay, all that money in the bank, so what? It's judgment day. Every aspect of being a disciple would be far easier if we pray like that. Yet we don't, because we have something we want and we didn't get it. And I'm putting my foot down because I'm in charge, not the Lord. He says, you don't receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. And then he goes really raw on us. You adulterous people. Woo! Don't you know that friendship with the world is hatred toward God? The world is driven by their desires. The world is driven by their passions. And yet God's people are driven by pleasing our Lord. See, when hope is deferred, and I just want to get married, we'll spend money on the date before we put anything in the plate. When I think I want my kids to be saved, so I'm going to go give them an awesome birthday party and put nothing in. So the kids learn they're more important than God. We say, I don't have enough money, God. You haven't given me enough, so I got to work. That's why I'm not there. And so today, God feels loved when you give your acts of service. But it's not like the Old Testament. I give a dove. Okay, now my sins are forgiven. It's not like that anymore. The new covenant is a covenant of the heart. See, if you're a baptized disciple today, you're already saved. Amen? You're already saved. There ain't nothing you can do to be more saved. You can't give an extra dollar and be saved. You can't give an extra penny and be more saved. You can't sing a song and be more saved. You can't get, there's nothing you can do. We can leave this place spotless. We can bring the roof down with our singing. We're no more saved. And yet, why do we do it then? One simple reason. Janelle and Rico hit it right on the head. Because what Jesus did for us. He gave his son for you. He gave everything for you. So that you would love him by giving everything back. Fourthly, one of people's favorite love languages, gifts. You like getting a good gift, don't you? Like, do you want the zirconian little earrings or do you want the diamond ones? When you go to the party, do you want Coca-Cola or Ralph's Cola? Shasta Cola. I don't know, some people like Shasta. And yet, like I started out with, God's love languages are also our love languages. Oh, we hear about these love languages, go, well, I like that. That's great. Yeah, I like that when people do that to me. I like when I get that. And yet we love it when people spend money on us. We love when people just do it up, all the decorations, the incredible food, and we just love that. And we should do those things for each other. Go to 1 Chronicles 29. 1 Chronicles 29. God says, I like gifts too. Contribute to me generously. Yeah, there wasn't much clapping on that one, dang. Woo, hit a nerve. Hit a nerve, you like your money. That's okay, we all like our money. And money is needed for everything. Just some of us test the Lord and get more than we can handle, and others don't, and they don't ever have enough. 1 Chronicles 29, verse 1. King David was said to have a heart after, his heart was after God's own heart. Then King David said to the whole assembly, my son Solomon, the one whom God has chosen, is young and experienced. You know, sometimes God just gives you a young, inexperienced leader. I mean, you see all the Bible talk leaders. There's a lot of new Bible talk leaders. Yeah. That's awesome. Yeah. You notice we didn't import in a whole bunch of Bible talk leaders for you? Because you're fully capable. Yeah. Says, the task is great. Because this palatial structure is not for man, but for the Lord God. Well, that should give us some perspective right there why we do what we do. Yeah. We are building a kingdom worldwide. See, Solomon, who was so inexperienced, was building a physical temple for the Lord, where the Lord would reside. We're building a spiritual one around the world where the Lord will reside. Amen? And yet, there's so many young and inexperienced. Does that really matter when God's in charge? Does it really matter? Does it matter if your preacher's a doof, nerd, computer guy? Does it really matter? If God's really in charge, then why so much fear? If God's really in charge, why so much looking and, let me check this guy, check you out. Brother? Certainly, we should guard this door from sin coming through that door. But when you're looking at any leader or any person like that, you just brought the sin in the house. Because it's love God, love people, and we don't leave any person out in this room. This palatial structure that we're building is for the Lord and no one else. It is for our God because He is mighty and great. He says, with all my resources, I have provided for the temple of my God gold for the gold work, silver for the silver, bronze for the bronze, iron for the iron, and wood for the wood, as well as onyx for the settings, turquoise, stones of various colors, and all kinds of fine stone and marble. All of these in large quantities, because that's just how we roll in the kingdom, amen? Besides, in my devotion to the temple of my God, so that's the kingdom, right? Because of my devotion, over and above everything I have for this temple. Everything we have is supposed to be for building the kingdom. He says 3,000 talents of gold, gold or ophir, 7,000 talents of refined silver for the overlaying of the walls of the buildings. Why do you need that? Why do you need gold on the walls? Couldn't you just leave them brick? No. We couldn't. Because God wants gold. I don't understand it. I don't like it, but I don't care. He's God. That's, we want to understand God, and His ways are just not our ways. He says, for the gold work and the silver work and for all the work done by the craftsmen, now who is willing to consecrate himself today to the Lord? Woo! That was a question for you. There's God talking to you right there. Are you going to join the tribe, really? This is a tribe. This is a family. We guard ourselves. We protect ourselves. We are in this together. It says, then the leaders of the families, the officers of the tribes of Israel, the commanders of thousands and the commanders of hundreds and the officials in charge of the king's work gave willingly. They gave toward the work of the temple of God 5,000 talents and 5,000 derricks of gold, 10,000 talents of silver, 18,000 talents of bronze, and 100,000 talents of iron. Any who had precious stones gave them to the treasury of the temple of the Lord in the custody of Jehiel the Gershonite. The people rejoiced at the willing response of their leaders, for they had given freely and wholeheartedly to the Lord. David the king also rejoiced greatly. This is how much he rejoiced. He said, okay, I don't have joyful noise, so I'm going to do it. David praised the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly, saying, praise be to you, O God, God of our father Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory. That sounds like one joyful noise song right there. And the majesty of the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. Wealth and honor come from you. You are ruler of all things, and in your hands are strength and power. To exalt, to give strength to all. Now, our God, we give you thanks and praise your glorious name. But who am I and who are my people that we should be able to give as generously as this? That is why we do special missions. I hope you don't base your giving off the people you see in front of you or what you think of them. Yeah. I really don't. That's a dangerous place for you to be in if you do. Yeah. I'm going to say this. This is recorded. It's going out to the whole world. I don't want your money. I don't need your money. I'm not here for your money. I mean, you all have been to my home. You've seen it. You see what we have. You see what we do. I don't want your money. And if you don't want to give it, I don't want it. Please don't put blood money in that plate. This is to build the kingdom of God. If you want to know the heart, Acts 2, Acts 4, 2 Corinthians 8, 2 Corinthians 9, 1 Corinthians 16, it's all in there. I'm not going to cover it today. But I want you to think about the great leaders we read about in the Bible. I mean, you think about Peter. Was he not awesome? He's the loudmouth. He's the ear chopper. I mean, this guy was crazy. But he's the one that jumped out when walked on water. He's the only guy, other than Jesus, to walk on water. That guy's flat amazing. And yet he flat lied that he even knew Jesus. He was a liar. Oh, I can't give my money to him. Why would I give my money to a liar? You think about the apostles. Acts chapter 6, go read about it. They were mistreating other disciples. Their disciples going without food because they were being overlooked in the daily distribution. Why am I going to give my money to that leader? Because you're not giving it to a leader. You're giving it to God. You think about John Mark. We're sending two mission teams out from this little region right here. Is that not awesome? And yet, in the first century, they gave to the missions every year. They gave for the missions and to meet the needs of those who were poor around the movement. That's exactly why we give. And yet one of their missionaries, John Mark, the one loved by Jesus, you know that, right? He's the one that Jesus loved. And he abandoned everybody on the mission field and went back home and bagged it on everybody. Why can't I? Oh, I'm not giving my money to him. These are the guys that we read about that inspire us. And yet, they had all the same sins of anybody you've ever seen. Here's the patterns in the scriptures of real disciples. They gave as needed, whenever needed, to meet each other's needs and the needs of a growing movement. And that's what we're going to do in this church here. Amen? I think about even just personally what I've received from the kingdom. Being a disciple. You know, we have this phenomenal thing that we call discipling, where we get together and help each other with our lives, help each other be obedient. Some of us think it's therapy. It's really not therapy. It's really just training to be obedient. And yet, I think about myself personally. The first day I came to church of my own accord, my mom dragged me a couple times. But, and I was very nasty to the disciples. I shouldn't be a disciple. Yeah? You hear why Zira? My son dragged me too. There you go. Hey, you know what? Drag him here. You know? I'll be grateful later. Not by the hair, but drag him in. Amen? But the first Sunday I came on my own accord, I came in wearing a tie-dye t-shirt, tie-dye shorts, and I was wearing a real big attitude. And I was lazy, selfish. I only thought about me. Everything was about me. And I did not like people. My dad was a phenomenal guy that worked hard. I never had to worry about anything to eat, nothing. I had to worry about getting beat, but I had food to eat. So amen. Love you, Dad. My dad and I talk almost every day now. I kiss him on the mouth every time I see him. I show him respect. I love him with all my heart. That's only because of God. But I think about as a man, my father taught me to work hard, and yet I was lazy. The kingdom taught me to honor what my father taught me growing up. I didn't work hard, and yet I ended up working my way from being the mail boy to being the director of IT for a publicly traded company. And that's not me. That's not me. That's discipling. That's great men saying, no, you're going to take that next job and you're just going to keep it up. The first one to give you a job, you're taking it. And work with all your heart and all your might and see what God will do. That would have never happened if I didn't have great men in my life doing that. See, God gave me a great gift. We give gifts to God. He gave me that gift to be a great provider for my family when I wasn't. I think about us giving to God and why it's so hard. Why, you know, some of you are visiting. We don't talk about the money thing like this all the time, but every year we raise money for churches. And I think about people who sold their homes, sold their wedding rings, and that's why I'm here. Because of what they did. And we talk about it once a year, quite a bit for a month or two, because I honor that. I honor how powerfully God has moved in people's lives and what they gave up because of Him for me. And so I shamelessly talk about it. I make no apologies for talking about it. And that's why we raise money. The Bible talks about giving beyond your ability. And boy, this year we're giving beyond our ability, are we not? And so, we have a goal for our special missions that we do. And it's we got $61,000 left, amen? I believe we're going to hit it. Because you guys are giving all your hearts. And yesterday we did an event called tagging. That's what we call it. And we went out and we raised money. Stand up if you went tagging yesterday. Stand up if you went tagging. And these kids, you guys are flat amazing. And I mean, go back one picture. Nope, forward one right there. Sierra and Jasmine, I want you guys to stand up. Okay, guys, like, seriously, I have this portable speaker that's like these ones, but is battery powered. It'll go for 5 hours, right? And we gave these two women a mic for 5 hours on the corner of a street. And I have never seen anything like that in my life. It was phenomenal. And I just want to lift you two up before everybody. You got to get this. So we're raising money, and we raised $1,050 yesterday, man. Not only did we raise $1,050, we handed out almost 1,900 invites to church. Before I even got home, one of the ladies called Tracy because her number was on the card and said she's coming to church next week. I just want you to picture this, the intersection, right? We're at the intersection, and the light turns red, and everybody comes up to the red light, and they're coming to a stop, and you got Jasmine on the mic going, "Welcome to the red light!" And let me tell you, people were honking and clapping and cheering and going through the intersection, turning around, coming back, walking across the street to hand money. It was awesome. It was awesome. I've never seen someone do what little Miss Jasmine did. Joined up with Sierra was just amazing. But she's like, dig down in your cup holder. We'll take even the soaked in Diet Coke pennies. Just give me a penny. A penny, and she goes, a penny changed my life. Like, wow. She's walking up to the window, right up to the window. Hey, can a dollar save a life? Come on. You got a dollar, right? Are you going to buy a soda or are you going to save a life? I was just like, woo. Some people were like hard the whole time, and then right before the end, they roll the window down. Boom, here you go. Take it. $20. Bam. It's like that. And that money, that $1,000, is going to multiply past what $1 million could ever do in this world. Let me tell you what, God felt loved by all these people that went out and gave their heart yesterday. You met God's love language. He feels loved by you. That was awesome. And it just, it brings me to tears how much love these people have. But you know what? That was $1,000. The number of people we have is in direct proportion to how much we make. In the same amount of time, if half of you were there, we'd have $4,000 in the bank right now. Please show up next Saturday. I ain't too proud to beg. I'm not. Let's go on into our final point. I'm going a little long. The final love language, physical touch. Turn to John chapter 12. Physical touch. You might be thinking, Ron, how can physical touch be one of the love languages for God? I can't physically touch him. Well, that's a good question, and I'm glad you asked that today. Our final point is physical touch, die for me. Now, stay there in John 12. You don't need to turn to Genesis, but Genesis 1, God made man. And in verses 22 and 28, the very first thing God said to that man he created was, be fruitful. Increase in number, fill the earth, and subdue it, and rule over it. You are made to rule this earth. You go, well, I'm not a leader. You are now. Because you're made in the image of Jesus, and he was nothing but a leader. So, man filled the earth and subdued it. And then man got prideful and got all about himself and all about his desires and made the whole earth evil. So God had to wipe the face of the planet. We all know the story. Then it was interesting to me that in Genesis 9, once Noah saved his family and they were the only ones to start over, what God said to them. Can you imagine what God said to them? Be fruitful, increase in number, and fill the whole earth. And yet, what's the impact of being fruitful? Montserrat, that was phenomenal today. That was phenomenal. You have an amazing heart for God. And yet, did you realize that she physically touched Jesus today? She came in contact with the blood of Jesus today. Physical touch. The only thing I can think of, any of you see the movie The Matrix? Yeah. See Matrix 2 and 3?
Yeah.
Okay, I want you to think about this in a good way. Agent Smith, he goes, and he sticks his finger in. And then the hole just... In a good way. That's what the blood of Jesus does when we come in contact with this. All our sin, just a whole new person. Every time you are fruitful, you help someone come in contact and physically touch God. But in order for you to be fruitful, there's something that you've got to do for God. And you can't do it for yourself. You can't do it for your Bible talk. You can't do it for our church. You've got to do it for Jesus because he did this for you. John 12, verse 23, you got to die. Jesus replied, the hour's come for the Son of Man to be glorified. I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, oh man, if it dies, it's beautiful. If it dies, it produces how many seeds?
Many.
Fruitfulness is an exact representation. You know, when a seed from a strawberry grows into a plant, you don't get an orange. You get a strawberry. It's funny how that works, you know? And yet you, a real disciple, When you help someone come in contact with the blood of Jesus, there's another you and another Jesus. There's a representation of Jesus that has your heart that you've put into that person. And we physically can touch Jesus. We know all men's love language is physical touch for the most part. And it's also God's because we're made in His image. The man who loves his life will lose it, while the man who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. What in you is not like Jesus today? Visiting, not visiting, it doesn't matter. What in you is not like Jesus? Who have you died for lately? Because Jesus died for you so that you again and again would die for someone else. What does it mean to die? Let's let the Bible speak. Our final scripture, 2 Corinthians chapter 6. 2 Corinthians chapter 6 in verse 1. I want God to be loved by you, but I also want you to understand how to feel loved by God more than ever. And it's understanding this concept. As God, fellow workers, we urge you to not receive God's grace in vain. For he says, in the time of my favor, I heard you. In the day of salvation, I helped you. I tell you that now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. We put no stumbling block in anyone's path so that our ministry will not be discredited. If I ever do anything, say anything that puts a stumbling block before you, please just come and tell me. Because I never want to do that to any of you. Amen? That would discredit everything that I do up here in our ministry every day. If I hurt you and put a stumbling block in front of you and then don't fix it. So please, if I do something or Tracy does something, please just come and tell us. We've been regular disciples of Jesus for most of our life spiritually. We've been in the ministry almost 10 years, but we spent most of our life not in the ministry, sitting out just like all the rest of you. And we understand both sides of it very well. And I just want you to feel loved and inspired and want to see God do everything with you that he can do. But he says, rather as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way. Now remember, everything in God's kingdom is backwards, right? So this is how you're commended by God. In great endurance, in troubles, hardships, distresses, in beatings, imprisonments, in riots, in hard work, sleepless nights, hunger, in purity, understanding, patience, and kindness, in the Holy Spirit and in sincere love, in truthful speech and in the power of God, with weapons of righteousness in the right hand and the left, through glory and dishonor, bad report, good report, genuine yet regarded as imposters, known yet regarded as unknown, dying yet we live on, beaten yet not killed, sorrowful yet always rejoicing, poor yet making many rich, having nothing yet possessing everything. Today, I pray you feel loved by God. And I pray that you walk out of here desiring to make God feel loved by you more than ever before in your life. God has made us in his own image. The Lord needs our love, and we need his and each other's. Today, spend quality time with the Lord and each other. Give him words of affirmation that you love him and trust him and obey him, and give each other words of affirmation. Do acts of service for him and for each other. Give generously to him and give generously to each other when someone has need. And physically touch him by dying to yourself and helping others come in contact with the blood of Jesus. And we will change this world for eternity. I love you all very much. Have an incredible day.